Professor Jaramoni session today. And the lecturer is Professor Gabriela Vienitz from Berkeley. And this will be a highly experimental talk. Let's see.
Yeah, thank you. So I need to know from you whether I need microphone, because I will need to keep it in my hand, and that's highly undesirable. So if you see that I'm speaking too low, I'll feel this, but if you can hear me, then I would rather do without. No complaints? Okay. If this will be too low, too quiet, you just go. So my name is Rosina Albany. I work in law in Berkeley, National Laboratory in Berkeley. National Labs in the United States are private country. They are just facilities which don't have to make money. They are just spending money. They are doing basic research. This is what is happening in Berkeley, law in Berkeley, National Laboratory. So when I was boarding my plane in San Francisco 2 days ago, I have this view in mind. And apparently, as you see, it was exaggeration. So I would like to show you this one, which is Lauren Berkeley National Laboratory. This is where we work. This is an advanced microscope. So if you look and you have good eyes, you see Golden Gate Bridge, further on Hawaii and Japan. So this is absolutely fantastic view and also incredible facility. There's over 4,000 PhDs working on here, a lot of facility which is allows us to build beautiful instrumentation, which doesn't happen in university. They're so big, they're so big budget. Very special place, very unique place. And the reason I'm telling you that is that this is a place where many things might happen but cannot happen in other places. I understood you, I'm the only experimentalist. So it's a little bit challenging, but also extremely pleasant. So please stop anytime you feel I'm saying something you don't get it. I was very happy to repeat or explain. I understand that I'm talking to an audience which is not very accustomed to the language we're using every day. I have also a habit of putting small quizzes and tests. And these two lectures are next to each other, so I cannot do it after every lecture. I will do it after two. You'll have tomorrow 5 minutes. You don't sign your name. I'm not interested who said that. I'm interested in what you get from my lectures. This is totally for me to know what I have to repeat and explain. Because you guys, majority of you are theorists, and certain things may look foggy or unclear. And my goal is just to leave you with a clear picture, with understanding, not just spend a few hours talking to you and you having just a fog and screen in front of you. This is not why I'm here, and this is not why you are here. So you will have a test, you will not sign your name, you will answer several things, and I will know what to repeat in our first in my first class with your first session, okay? So this is my title is face QCD phase diagram, and we'll really get to it later on. First, I would like to condition you to let you know what you are doing, why you are doing, etc. That when we get to face diagram, QCD phase diagram, we will be very comfortable with the subject. First disclaimer, important caveat. This is not a review of heavy ion experimental talk. This is not a review of heavy ion experimental results. This is not a review of heavy ion experimental physics results. And for you to remember, it's not a review of heavy ion experimental results. Instead, I am presenting in my view why we are doing it, what we are doing, where we are doing, and how we are doing it. That you get a feel what it is, experimental heavy ion physics. Then you can take any report from the proceedings and go to the particular talks, read the latest experimental accomplishments, results, and you know where to place it. But the main thing is just idea why we are doing what we are doing, and you know why experiment is so important. So, in 2002, at the very beginning of this millennium, discovered and published 11 physics questions for the new century. And there is a council of the wise men, they call them National Research Committee on Physics of the Universe. And out of these 11 questions, 3 are directly related to what we are doing. 2 in red, 7 and 11 are just exactly our field. sex was kind of borderline. After the new state of matter, I have temperature density. This is what we are basically focusing our experiments on, and how did they develop the game. So perhaps during the physics, for number one, you can feel more about with the one stone. So these lectures are about, first, why? Introduction to Hegelian physics, the way I see it, why we study QCD, phase diagram, why it is so important. Then I will give a short tour of a complete experiment that you will know where and how. Where these numbers are coming from? You see experimental distribution, you feed the Boltzmann distribution, you get your temperature and you are happy. You need to know where they come from, so you understand how solid it is, how accurate it is, and where are just soft spots that you can not really work but very much trust your parameters for the feed. Then we'll turn knobs and we'll go further on to the error result of human program and turn knobs further and we'll go a little bit about the second phase of this experiment, second phase of this program, which hopefully will lead us to what we are all aiming for, critical form, diagram, and understanding where is the phase transition line, where the boundary between phases of this, the most important graph of our field, UCD phase diagram. And again, a little bit of apology. Sense of small requires a very good understanding of law of nature that governs the world. It is not easy because law of nature are complicated. To appreciate the rock solid law of physics, we actually cannot avoid mathematics. So very often we need to translate from math to English. This is what our randomly do. And in the process of doing that, there's some mess involved, and we have to deal with it. There's no way that I can do it very accurately in the course of few hours of lecture, but I'm doing the way that you know why I'm doing and what we are doing and what to learn from it. It is possible, but part of the picture will be lost. Translation, mathematical formula to English is somehow impossible without a little bit of cheating. The goal is to get you some rough idea about the situation while avoiding the details. No much history. I'll leave history to historian. I'll keep only about what I need it. And don't expect me to give you a brief run through the discovery and time. That's not what I meant with this lecture. So these lectures are what we know and what is next. So it is not so simple. Two important aspects of law of physics. Many laws of nature stay as they are. As they are when we change the scale. But there are phenomena that do not. They do not change accordingly. If you take a piece of paper and you build your airplane, it will fly. Then you take half of it, you build maybe fly. But you get to a tiny one, 5 meters, 5 meters, even you cannot fold it. The same look at the water. You have a bucket, you pour it, you have flow, you take it. You pour the flow, but you have one drop. The flow property allows. So remember, law which you are having in every day may not work in the small dimension, the small scale. Work of very fine object is not, in fact, it's not necessarily the same as we use. So in particle physics, ever smaller, ever higher energy. We go here in the scale, and I put here a few pictures. This is Rutherford in his lab. This is one some kind of linear, I don't remember what it was, this picture. This is us. This is the Benetton in Berkeley, the first real super machine which dealt with heavy ions. When I came to Berkeley very years ago, it was the first experiment I know around on Benetton. This is already retired. It's decommissioned. It's a parking lot in this area. And fantastic physics which was done with this. We stay with us fire. This is that. And of course, Stellatron in Fermi lab. So if you see here, exploring small scales is always requiring more energetic growth. We build more and more high energy accelerators. Originally, it was just local, in particular countries. Right now, expect is impossible. So it's a huge international collaboration. Many thousands of physicists, technicians, engineers involved. But story goes on and on. So about the understanding. when you have a lecturer, there are many reasons why you might not understand the speaker. He or she has a not very perfect language, may say things upside down, may say something what he or she doesn't mean, so you have to deal with it. This is the way it is. Very often, your lecturer, particularly as a physicist, uses ordinary words in the funny way. Work means something else for the physicist, particularly theoreticians, and something else in the street, but they prepare stuff. So you also have to deal with it. This is an easy trap. I will try my best to avoid it. I think I can do it. But you have to remember that what we mean is in our work, in physics work, not necessarily in general. So I'm describing you how nature works. And you won't understand why nature works this way. And you will be uncomfortable for it, but nobody does. Just what it is. My American students always, I sometimes say, this is the way God made it, and they accept it. It is the way we may know one day, but certainly not now. We are checking things which we can, and we leave rest to the interpretation. That's the reason we are using all these models. We really don't know the rest. Finally, about understanding. After doing something, you just can't believe it. You can't accept it, or you don't like it. And the smoke is dream comes upon you, and you don't pay attention, and that gets in the way to understand it. Physicists learn to deal with it, and you also have to learn to deal with it. This is not important whether you like theory, whether it's very comfortable, intuitive, whether it makes sense, you can follow. This is not important. The only important question is a contested experimental. So this theory gives a prediction which you can measure, check, assign error bars, and verify. This is the only criteria which is working, and you have to remember. All other theories are on the way to be interesting. So it is important, and you have to keep in mind this is for all your scientific, career. So what matters make of? Even ancient Greeks were very interesting. They believed fire, water, earth, and air. And I have here this fantastic Stonehenge to tell you about 2,000 or 3,000 years ago. So we have this information from the radiation measurements of the carbon 13. They can assess very well the data. But we still believe it is in the middle of England, 15 miles north of Salisbury, and it's concentric shape, huge stones erected after this car. And it's believed that people were trying to find out where the beginning of the universe was coming from, what it is, what it was, what it's going to be. So this is one of the first astronomical observatories. And it is very important how vital this problem was here, was always. And we are not much different. But many times now we accelerate a few machines to recover situation, to understand situations from the Big Bang, etc. But this is absolutely fantastic. It's in the middle of 5,000 or 6,000 or 7,000, the number of continuously changing because we are digging new ones, birthstone around, beautiful thing. And then we start to think, what did this thing building this? Huge, monumental. Now fast forward. We are going forward. I will bring you to what we are right now thinking. And we know the concept of force introduced by Newton, the concept of field introduced by Faraday, so far so good. Then we have this double nature of the light. Is it a particle? Is a wave? With a wave? And we have here quantum mechanics which finally dealt with it. And then was connected with the special relativity and got quantum field theory. And here you will have probably very many interesting talks in this regard because it's a hot item, the best theory we have. One of them is QED, which is well understood, well tested, beautifully confirmed experimentally. But the one we are talking here about is the one which deals with the theory of strong interactions is quantum chromodynamic, QCD. And this is on the very bottom of my story, but it's really the topic of this school. So theories, many theories and discoveries of the last century led us to remarkable insight that everything in the universe is found to be made from 12 basic building blocks. And you know that we have quarks and gluons, and you know that we have four kinds of forces, and you know that every detail of it, every volume. What I hear from, I would like to remember that gravitation is not part of the standard model. So we have 12 components, but only three forces. There's no way to connect gravitation and relativity, special relativity, that they mathematically form one thing. Like two children who don't want to play in the same box. So this is out. So Newton will be turning into gray. It's not really very important because particles are very light. Why would you worry about gravitation in such a small object? And people kind of make a peace with it. Gravitation does not belong to standard model. And in certain sense, it is frustrating because we thought we know everything, apparently we don't. So, back to QCD, you know that fundamental particles are quarks and gluons, and new things discover charge. It is not what I want to talk to you. I really want to talk about two other things. Confinement asymptotic freedom, you know that you cannot separate quarks, they will produce another pair, and they are short distances, they are very weak interactions. We all know that, but the real reason I brought it up is that I would like to continue attention to QCD predicts first transition to quark-gluon plasma. It's a very high temperature and a very high pressure in a very extreme condition, high energy density. There will be transition of the phase change to the new phase and we call them quark-gluon plasma. Cosmology also knows this term. The models do have quark-gluon plasma just after Big Bang, like this is first explosion of our universe, just after birth of the new world. So it is the same phenomenon, and we can address it from quite from not the only one angle, but from more. So this is a picture which QCD provides. On the left hand side, you can see here the confined state. So you see hadrons in their bags. Very many of them, the bags are not interfering with each other. Then you change the temperature and you get to kind of jump about TC 307. There is no newest thing, is slightly lower number. Theory seems that it's maybe less than that. And then we see this jump, and what's happening further, you have the other state, which is boundaries became irrelevant, they overlap. They basically merge in each other, disappear, and you have a free state of quark gluons moving freely. And actually, if this is really no interaction about them, you will see it next. It is something what theory was telling us this should be, it shouldn't be any, but we experimented with this, I said we have to test it, and we did. Actually, about quark soup, quark gluons, the first time in history of optical physics, was already in 75 with Colin and Perry. And here is a front page of the article, and I will just read it to you. Newton has a radius of very small, up to 1/3, and has a density of about 10 to 14, whereas the central density of Newton's star can be between 10, 15, 17. So you see, it's covered over surrounding the high. In this case, one must expect the column to overlap and the individuality be confused. Therefore, we suggest that methods have high density is a quark soup. So 1975, we have the first paper which called by the name quark-gluon plasma quark-gluon soup. So we see right now the standard model tells us that QCD calculation predicts QCD to confinement about 150-170 temperature. We know from cosmology that this phase transition in the early is the beginning of the early universe after Big Bang exploded. And we see that in astrophysics, we expect that will also in the dense core of the stars. So question is, can we make it in the lab? This is what we're after. We would like to basically get it, measure it, learn about it, and then basically constraint model around which are dealing with this. The cosmology is beautiful thing, but it's a passive way of learning. We would like to learn the active way, we like to make it, keep it very, very difficult because we need very short time, but we need to learn during this very short time what it is. And this is my digression, very short one. Cosmology is a question from my first slide. How did the universe begin? And obviously everybody is looking into, from time to time into stars, sky, and think, what else? What all other wonders are there? Planets? And what else? And this way, through the centuries, people were asking questions, and relatively late became Big Bang model, theory of acceptance, which speaks about evolution of the early universe, is postulated 12 to 14 million years ago. The portion of the universe you can see today with only a few millions across, tiny one, and then since then expand, cool down. On the end we have a world we're living in. So question is, how did we get from here? This is more user-friendly picture, lying on the side. This is the time, and you see the inflection, Big Bang, quark. So this is what we are trying to make in the laboratory to see whether this is really whether we can have it and keep it or discard it and go for something else. Then with the time expansion cooling down and the other ends, we have our world we are living. Of course, first light elements were formed, later on heavy elements, everything with the dissipation of energy we would expect. So, what we are doing in the laboratory right now, we are trying to kind of reverse mindset. We are trying to make the attention. We would like to go back here and see what's going on. And we can do it only because accelerators probably presently available to carry us through this transition. So can we create it in the lab? As we said in the very beginning, I mentioned it, unless you can confirm it experimentally, it's not good. So we better make a way to find it. And this phase transition like others. You don't have a problem with ice heating, going to water, going to steam. Human plasma phase is not anything else. This is after transition situation with our regular matter. How do we do it? If you squeeze very strongly, I have here this business is supposed to be a cube of ice, and at certain point, if you squeeze very, very strong, the boundaries won't be relevant anymore. So how do you do it? You do it all through the high pressure. You squeeze and start, since that's overlap, they are not very important anymore. All that heat you produce from excitation, new particles, density goes very high, and again this boundaries between components are not equal. Well, you can do both. In this way, you will have very, very simple, you can do both, so you will have two factors, perhaps you will get what you want much faster. So, presenting you the summary. So present understanding, you have neural matter confined. We add heating, so we are producing these extra particles, exchange, we get higher density, but also we are getting higher temperature. We do compression, and boundaries are not important anymore, they disappear, and you get the confined matter. And this is what QCD is showing us. This is the plot they are offered, and we would like to test it. And let's go back to my main question, mini bank in the lab. How do we do it? We need a system which we accelerate to the very high speed. We are very, very close to the speed of light. But we need a system, not individual particles, because we would like to use thermodynamics. So we need an ensemble, we need a system. So So we need to cut a chunk of matter. And we will use heavy ions, even gold, which is very heavy, very tiny, but has 197 protons and neutrons, and has a thin volume which can be exposed to pressure and temperature. So we will try to force matter, we know, through the phase transition to the state, which was also expected to be permanently done, and according to the class. So this is basically the strategy. So now you know how. You know why. Now we will go maybe to how. So to be more specific, how to find and explore quantum plasma by pulling large nuclei at the highest possible energy. Now, question is how high is too high? So critical temperature is about 2 times 10 to 12. Just keep in mind that it's 1,000 times more than the temperature of sun, of the center of sun. This is 1,000 billions. Incredible number. And we also need a critical energy density, which is much higher than normal. Can we do it? I already give you the right? Yes, we can. But there are requirements, right? System must be in equilibrium. Remember, we're using thermodynamics. We would like to learn about using thermodynamic tools. So we better know that it's in equilibrium. System must be dense and large. And the question is, what is it in equilibrium? What kind of component, species, the two number two, I have here a few numbers for you to remember. Hadron, delta V zero, volume, about 172. When you think about heavy ion collision, it's about 1,000 times more. This is a huge number. This is a huge number. It's a number which allows us to use thermodynamic tools. The same with the energy density. We are squeezing the nuclei to the point that we are probably up to 20 times more than 0.15, and these conditions are satisfactory. At least assumptions are satisfactory. Now let's see if we make how we do it in practical terms. We already know the numbers we have to reach. So we have to run high energy nuclear collision, and we have machine. We need machine which can do it. And there is a one, it's called relativistic heavy ion collider in the United States, which can accelerate anything on anything up to 200 GeV to root of S in nuclear collision. And I will talk about that. So I said it already before, accelerator function a little bit like a time machine. They take us to the early state of universe. And this picture was already on the previous lectures. I have just schematic. We're talking about different stages of the collision, not everything at once. We have approaching, we have collision, we have high density state. This is the one which I think is our main suspect and interest range. And then by terms of cooling and expansion, particles go away, stop to interact, and they become normal nuclear matter which we get in our detectors. And this is what I would like to show you. This is the area on the chart for the beginning of the universe model, and this is the stage of the nuclear collision. And we think they are the same. So learning about one, you learn about the other. But remember, what we have is just a final state. This is a picture from star experiment, from TPC, from view. This is what you have in central collision going on. So they are already halos, they are already coming to detectors, you already have them in the kind of normal world. And you have somehow to recover their memory to know what happened ever. This is not simple, but this is what we do. So this is a picture for you, and the question is, who will tell me what's wrong with this picture? The dear colleague Shinya won't make class, but what's wrong? I told you this velocity of light, right? We are talking about incredible velocity, and they are not over, they are just flat, tiny, very simple sheets of matter. There's no such shape. It has to be very, very thin. We're accelerating them to the incredible velocity. So where it is in the east part of US, it is Long Island here. It is east from New York. This is Long Island, and he works for Harvard National Laboratory. This is the place where they sit. So we'll go there, and Poland is a member of the Commonwealth. It's very funny. It's a Polish flag. So this is white part is kind of blending with the red one. But Poland is member, and the Polish scientists on all experiments. Presently, only two experiments are. This is finished. Originally, were four of them, two smaller ones, Fawaz and Brahms, and they completed their mission. They had a commission. They went for a tournament. Presently, also Phoenix completes the program and is going through the conversion to S Phoenix. New reincarnation of this experiment. Stan is still very much happy experiment in running baby data. As we speak, we are right now running. Starting in the beginning of February, it will be run to mid of July. So STARS is running even now. What's happening there? So you have a project which goes here. You see it's number 6 here. I'll tell you in the next slide. But it's not that you are starting in the collider. It has to be a number of stages that you are accelerating one by one. So you get two of them to two different rings. And they collide in these four intersections. So what you see here is a little bit similar. We have here, we start from the Van der Graaf, then it goes here to AGS, which is alternating Lenin synchrotron. It is the first big machine on the East Coast, which was functioning when we ran the SPS experiment. It was the machine of the United States. Here we have a linear, which delivers problems when we need it. So we accelerate this. Goes here, this transfer line goes to the yellow ring, goes to the blue ring, and the collisions in four places, at least the original four places. So this is just a kind of graph, and it starts to strip ions from electrons. We need electrons away because we need a charge, we need to have a handle how to handle this. Ions, so we cannot accelerate atoms. There is no way that they will ignore our electric field. So we strip them, and as you see, it will be more and more. Every single step is less, more strict electrons, so it is more vulnerable and accelerated. This is the proper linear. Next one is booster, and this is just kind of short that we do and seeing how it looks like. This is AGS, alternating with the same. Then comes here to transformer, and you see here, enter to the yellow ring, and here enter to the blue ring. One batch goes there, one batch goes there. This is just going out and the we don't collide them, right? Yes, sir.
What's the role of a booster?
Booster?
Yeah, what does a booster do?
Enlarging energy and stripping to higher charge state. I'll
but
show you the next slide.
Yeah, but as opposed to an accelerator. Accelerator brings you to...
You cannot do it in one go. You cannot do it in one go. It's too much. You have incredible amount of energy. You have to use it. You will need to have a helium of infinite amount to cool everything. So you do it in steps. You will have an explanation in the David Meyer's picture. Just let me go. So you see what's happening. We have undercraft. I am coming from here. This is wrong. We don't need to stick it. But if you use substitute 1 mV, you come here to booster, the group is already 95 mV. Huge change. Actually, on the very beginning, it's just like with an object to start to move things from the velocity zero is hard. Later on, to give more boost is much easier. Physics. No, 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 no. Then it goes here, and again, go Q77, we go here to Q79, actually it's a big difference. And we get here what is the final energy which is provided to rig. Further accelerations happen inside the rig. Rig is a storage ring and a collider, the same place. You circulate till you ramp it up, we call it ramp it up. You put it on the screen and you see how it's going. Then you get your 200 G or whatever you want to run, and then you start to trigger. But first it's circulating and ramping up. They are increasing magnetic fields, they are increasing electric field, and they are increasing energy. So it's not like you put two beams there and have collision. No, it's much more complicated. So few facts about this. So two rings, as I said, huge amount of superconducting magnet and huge amount of liquid helium. Helium, 7 tons. It is incredible. Helium is expensive like hell, so it's really, really expensive. And the refrigerator to cool the helium needs a power which will be enough to heat so many houses. 20 years of world beam we didn't even use 1 gram of gold. Fumo 6 is flexible, dedicated heavy ion machine. This is the only flexible, dedicated heavy ion machine. Rest machines are working in the spare time between hadronic collisions. This is the one meant for heavy ion, so we run it as much as we can, or to be specific, as much as we get money for. It costs us about 150 million euros. We run it between 20 and 30 years, depending on how we deserve budget particular year. Can accelerate anything and at the same square root of S is calculated to ZA over 100. Exceeded design luminosity, fantastic conditions, 6 times. This is they meant to get something, and then they made improvement while they were testing, and we got fantastic luminosity. Luminosity is limited by scattering inside the beam. Coulomb is cruel on us. They are just pushing these guys away to the other. So when you run in smaller energy, nano side will be closer. They can be getting bigger. It's a disaster because your position goes down. You don't want it. So we are right now working on something called electron point. We'll be inserting electrons with the same velocity as ions, and we hope they will screen Coulomb. And since we're going back at the lower energy. I'm telling you about it because I will go to the lower energy in my next scan and you'll see how vital it is. So for the moment, I can see on the very bottom that this was a machine which was optimized, designed and optimized for 200 GV, and these guys from accelerator division were so incredibly skillful that they managed to bring down energy to lower, even when run lately not fast. This was so much better than if we didn't take enough data to discuss it as a physics accomplishment, but you know we can go there, perhaps it's electron cooling, but we got the lowest energy data at 7G. So it's become flexible machine. So as I said, it's dedicated, it's a collider, it's high energy, and it's comprehensive. Detectors are comprehensive. In the physics, when you run a big experiment, you have to avoid single aim detector. We need enough overlap to test things, to cross-check things against each other. There's very many conspiracy against you, and you have to be really very vigilant on every single thing. So all experiments at RIC have enough redundancy that we are pretty confident with the result. Also, we have a lot of redundancy among between experiments. This is very important. I'll talk about it later. But keep in mind that this is not really irrelevant how you design your experiment. So this is RIC, right? This is Collider. I said two big experiments, two small experiments. I have here pictures. They are different sizes. This is the biggest one. It's called Phoenix. It was sitting at 8 o'clock. This is Star, closest to my heart because I worked there almost 20 years. And this is Rams. And this is Phobos. This was particularly Phobos, almost tabletop experiment. I would like to say a few words about this one, but let me go to. I have a plan to tell you one by one. So, as I said here, we have more, we managed to go down to lower energies. So this is the biggest one, as I said, to me. You see, it looks like a turkey in the cross-section. Has very many layers of different detectors. You have channels, you have time of flight, very many detectors with enough redundancy and complementarity that you can get results. The second one is Star, and this is the one which I will use my AIMI data from. It is a large acceptance, full azimuth acceptance. Extremely important when you do correlation, extremely important when you do any information which is not, which is azimuthally dependent, because there's a many traps around, and you can go really very comfortably. It has huge it's not very fast because we see the rift. It's a huge thing. It's 2 meters of rift to each side. There's a membrane on the window, and you have to allow for the rift. So it's slow. By then, analysis of Hadron's heavy framework forward physics just encourages you to have beautiful results. And in 2014 to 16, we added something what we call heavy flavor tracker, superb accuracy versus the depth which allows to go after Dimas. Measure which contains C quarks, very important. So this is again started new, and it is a good example of the deep experiment. I'm talking about it because I know it very well. I would talk about other experiments if you wish, but I still don't know. So you see here this big TPC. Around this you have a BMC bar parameter. Besides that, we have a UPVPD that's a virtual detector, gets information on collision happened, gets information the same distance on both sides, coincidence, and tells us, aha, collision happened, turn on your lab, take the data. If there is too much difference in timing, this is off time, it is maybe better, don't take any problem. Then we have also EMCAL, NCAL, the same role as a boiler, but getting a higher rapidity, forward direction. We have the pumping on one side, to left, but that's the way it is. I would like enough to go back to more kind of technical level, but you see how the sandwich is happening. So this is our TPC, this is BMC around it. They are just triggering our parameter, so we have three onion rings around, right? And this is just forward, and we have here further away direction, forward direction. TPC is very important. If you notice right now, almost all big experiment in heavy ions looks like a copy of star. Alice has a TPC. A new experiment, as Phoenix I mentioned, is talking about TPC, will be compact TPC, but also TPC. So I said I will tell you in 2 words how does it work. So we have a particle going through the gas volume. Obviously, it's ionizing. Positive ions, slow pops, go very slowly to the negative and go very fast to the positive. When they get to the positive side, they leave a signal which we read. So from this we have x and y because it's two dimensions, that's and you know how tall and how wide it is, where is the x, y, and then from here, from here to here, we have a z, we have a third dimension. So we say about it that it's just three-dimensional 3D camera, it's not like CCD camera, but electronic, very fast and very efficient. And here I'd like also to, at the end, to tell you, impact parameters are important. You cannot dial impact parameters. You cannot tell experiment, run from 4 to 5 Fermi. That doesn't work this way. You take everything and then you do it offline. Of course you can select multiplicity, but it is more dependent, and you are not really doing any time up in the job. You are doing a bulk job. So we have here peripheral event, you see small amount of tracks. This is almost by eye, it's obstructable. Small aura. This is mid-central event, and you see life is more complicated. And this is very central event. And here you really have to have very sophisticated apparatus to be able to deal with it. This is a picture which is also very dear to my heart because we built TPC in a mirror. So we are part of this process. This is the outer skin of the field cage, tactile and copper layers. This inside is a skeleton. After this thing is very hard and keep a shape, etc. You pull this skeleton out and you don't have it, it's hollow. This is inner, so this goes in, and then goes at it's already finished. And this is ready to go. We made this everything in a year, and now the problem is how we transport it to the continent. Remember, the United States is a continent. You have in mind that the country was a huge country. And what we did, we asked the military, Air Force, US Air Force, to make a military operation. Wow. And they did. So we drove our beautiful TPC to the military base, which is in Napa Valley. They loaded it with a military plane, flew to Brookhaven, to JFK. From there, in the proper escort, was taken to Brookhaven, and he's already in our you're going to say. Remember, we are talking about the technology just the experience of my part. Has a tiny wires and nothing will broken. Fantastic operation, we're all excited. So here is on the end of this lecture, I would like to it's not really a joke, it's really serious, and think about how that personal matter you are. I have here a physicist for unknown reason like to categorize them in different classes. So you talk about experimentalists, theorists, you guys, accelerator physics technicians, and each class pretends to be dominant, things that others are just meant to serve them. And sometimes it is because other tedious calculations are not easy or not annoying, or maybe we have to benefit from someone. So there's a lot of work together, there's a lot of competition, usually it's a healthy competition, sometimes not. But really, what is the difference? And here is, I have a look here. Experimentalist has worked on a chemical equation that seems to explain the data. He asked his friend first to check. So experimentalists took these equations and again check the data. Works beautifully. According to our rules, that's the way you verify the theory. So he went back to his friend and asked him to check. The guy checked it and yes.
Yes.
But only in trivial case when numbers are real and positive. Well, how else would you experiment, right? So we have different languages and we are trying to make it consistent that we can communicate one. And here I have a second thing which I would like to show you. There are two species of us, right? Theorists trying to figure out how nature works, why stars shine, why the sky is blue. Experimentalists interrogate nature directly. Astronomers, physicists passively observing us actively, we're trying to talk around the mirror. So then here is a riddle. What is similarity and difference between following two sets? We have here a guy who is a farmer who is going to woods with his pigs to look for truffles. Pigs are addicted to, can be trained to be addicted to smell of truffles. So they really go and look, they are truffles under the soil, they find them, then he takes a bat, baseball bat, hit the pig and gets a truffle and his fish. So very expensive, $5,000 a kilo. So this is what he does. And then second is comparison with theories, experimentalists, and discovery. So we said what's happening with truffle hunter, but now more often than not, suggestion of theories take us experimenters to zoos that they are not truffles. By suggesting experiments which don't lead to interesting discovery. But there is notable exception to the rules, of course, progress can be made with trial and errors. But very often while looking for serious truffles, experimental find a little more. So nature is really unpredictable. And I will finish on this. So it's pressure.
Question is right. We have a right, and we have a second.
Okay.
So let's. Any
other question? Please. And also, if you want to have a second quiz, you can write in English, you can write in English, you can write in Czech. I can do it. Don't write in Czech.
And then that is a question.
Yeah, I still did not quite get the difference between a booster and an accelerator. So
accelerator,
the accelerator doesn't change the charge. The right. Booster does.
No. The charge state is a different problem. You impose it on the accelerating process. Booster is just push forward energy, not changing the charge. You need to change the charge to be more efficient, but that's in principle not a function booster. You put a silver foil or gold foil, you push through the foil and you strip the charge this way. It's a separate process that comes together, doesn't belong to the game. But we use it. Accelerator, linear, you know what it is, you just
linear is okay.
In terms of rhythm, It is basically two functions. First, a storage ring, and while you store in the ring, you accelerate. Every time you go in the field, it's getting boost. It's just quick. On the end, you find this energy right, you can see.
So yeah, we have the ring, which works as an accelerator, the big ring, and we have this smaller booster ring. So why it has a different
thing? You do it in steps. You cannot do 200 GV from zero. You do it in steps because I mentioned
sure,
that
yes.
At the beginning is such a huge dissipation of the power that you will be not able to do it.
But why it has a different name? Is it just historical?
No, by name or not.
It's also
It's
historical.
But so.
So,
AGS is a synchrotron, right? And booster is what kind of principle it uses to accelerate?
Yeah, it's just
booster is also synchrotron?
Exactly.
Okay.
No. It's in principle it's synchrotron, but you get it on the different range of the energy from two. You have to bring to AGS the proper energy threshold for something in order to get this working. AGS can deliver only 9.8. You will not go to 10. This is how the magnets are done. This is how optical system are done. So this is the reason you go step by step. Otherwise,
you should have completely different magnets, for example, to accelerate from zero to let's say.
And what is very important is optical system, right? You really want them to go. You don't want them to focus. So this is not a round, right? This is a because optical system is just this is optical system and magnetic system. So this is parallel. This is round. So it's hexagonal, not round. From far away, it's long enough.
Sure.
More questions? I'm here all week, so if you have something to ask, yes.
I might have a question to the electromagnetic principle.
That's a beautiful
thing. Yeah, I like that too, but I was wondering, so the rest frame of optical fields, these electrons are basically moving with them at this more or less the same speed.
Yes.
So how likely is it that they get recaptured from the ions?
This we don't know, it's right now tested. Apparently, they believe if they go with parallel, they may not be too much. The beauty is that we are trying to make parallel trajectories. And now is a question. You're asking about capture, right? This is not a done deal. This is right now a $10 million project which is going on. We hope in 2018 to apply it because we're running this to 2018. We know that it's not going smoothly. There are hiccups. Right now they are testing right now how much difference in velocity is acceptable. It is an idea which is right now in making. In a year or two, I will be able to give you more fun. For the moment, the idea of paper is brilliant. In practice, but not. So
and what is the physical principle of the cooling? How does it work?
You are
cooling means you need to reduce the fluctuation.
No, you are shielding. You are putting electron. What's happening in the when you are going with a very fast beams, the forward velocity is so thin that Coulomb has not much to say. When you are going to lower energies, Coulomb is so important that it's pushing beams to the side. So size of the beam is huge. It's a halo around the beam. So when you have to cross, if you cross, go to the diamond or you cross two beams, there's no much cross section because this is just halo. They go through each other. So your section for the collision, your data rate goes down. You don't want to, what we are working on is just to get the intensity high. So when you put it again, as I mentioned to your colleague, it is again idea in making, in testing. There is no cooling yet as experimentally proven. Nobody in the world knows how to do it. Guys in accelerator division in the book haven't worked on it. I work very close with them, so I know all details. We are talking about putting electrons to shield ions from each other, that Coulombs cannot really go through the barrier. How many electrons, how often, whether they go together, whether we go boost of a bunch of electrons after a bunch of ions, it's not clear yet. For the moment, this is, they call it done work. So they're working on many aspects of this thing. But, you know, these guys are in Brookhaven Accelerator Division are just incredible. They are not from this world, they're fantastic. They designed the accelerator for 200 GV. They managed to bring it down to 5. So it's just in hands of the very, very capable people, and I we believe there will be success or not yet.
At lower energies, I mean, COSY is a cooler synchrotron.
In
that works.
Energy is still but that's, low and low. Okay. This is 5GV, the lowest, 7GV. It's not
the principle has
it's
been
not a cis energy, right? It's not 2GV, 1GV. This, for us, is slow because we're dealing with 200. Yes, sir.
But to some extent, for free, you get a admittedly low energy and low luminosity, but still you get an electron ion collider.
Electron ion
collider?
You're talking about
where the electrons cool the ions, right? So they're running with the beam, I guess, in both directions. So some of the electrons will collide with the ions from the other direction.
Absolutely. This is the issue of how much we're going to have to
This is
in the middle of testing. I don't have the answer. Nobody has, because it is just a new thing that people are. Idea is very similar, just you have to implement and see what happens. More questions? Electron cooling, whatever? Anyway, please talk to me if you find something interesting.